about you, but I'm at a loss. See, I keep reading headlines about quantum computing and how it's gonna change the world, but every time I try to dig into what it actually is, I feel like my brain glitches out a little bit. But I'm not giving up, and today, I am on a quest to make quantum computing and what it means for our world understandable once and for all.
Basically, it's using quantum mechanics to compute things.
Yep.
But essentially, the idea is that unlike classical systems, in a quantum computer or a quantum device, you can have the system can be in two states at the same time. And that gives you a kind of parallelism that allows you to do two things at once in a way that for certain kinds of problems allows you to solve them potentially exponentially faster than you could ever do classically.
What? Okay, hold on. We gotta back it up a little bit. What does quantum mean? No, not like that. I mean in a physics way. So here's me. I'm made up of a bunch of different living tissues, which are made up of molecules, which are made up of atoms of all of the different elements we're made of. And our atoms are made of subatomic particles, protons, neutrons, and electrons. And then, if you can believe it, we can go even further down than that, because protons and neutrons are made up of even smaller particles called elementary particles, like quarks, leptons, and bosons. And this world of subatomic and elementary particles is what's called
the quantum realm.
And this is where the physics of things follow the rules of quantum mechanics, which basically means that at this level, things this small behave really strangely, like different than how the world behaves at the larger level of, say, you and me.
So classical computers work with digital logic, most of them, which means that you express everything in terms of bits that are zeros and ones, and you manipulate those with what are called logic operations, and that's the basis of a program. So you have some input bits, you manipulate them, you get some output bits, and that's your answer. And the magic of a quantum system is that you can have an analogous thing, but instead of a bit, you have what's called a quantum bit.
Qubit.
A qubit, that's
sounds
right.
Sounds really cute. Just to recap, this is how all of our computing that we're used to, which is called classical computing, works. We use electrons to send signals from one piece of machinery inside the computer to another. These signals are either on or off. There is either a flow of electrons at a discrete voltage or at another specific measurable voltage, and that's your signal. This on or off binary signal is encoded by us digitally in ones and zeros. That's how we tell the computer what we want it to do, and then how we read the signals that come out on the other end. This also means we're limited by a bunch of things, including the constraints of electricity, like the loss of energy through resistance and the generation of heat. It's also getting harder and harder to cram more and more transistors into smaller and smaller spaces. Like throughout computing history, we've seen steady progress in improvement of computing power, but we're reaching the end of that trend. We're reaching the limit of what's called Moore's Law.
There's never been anything like it in human history. It's really remarkable. We're now getting to the point where transistors are just a few tens of atoms across. So they just can't keep getting much smaller. Mm-hmm. And the cost of building the fabrication facilities is just phenomenal. And so it's very difficult to continue progress. So all projections are that in the early 2020s, this will have run its limit. So what'll happen then?
This is where all kinds of computing innovation comes in, including quantum computing. So back to how quantum computers do what they do. With one classical computing bit, that unit can give us two answers, one or zero, yes or no, on or off, you get the picture. But in quantum computing,
instead of being just zero or one, it could be any sort of combination of zero and one. And then if you put two together, those can be in any combination of zero and one both. And so the size of the space that is effectively possible grows really quickly with the number of qubits you add.
Right.
And it's because they can be in this sort of all all the different states at the same time. Mm-hmm. You could imagine something that had every possible value between 0 and 1.
Sure.
And that would be pretty cool. But the quantum system actually does more than that. Not only can you have any number between 0 and 1, you can have what's called a phase. You can have a relative phase between 0 and 1. So this adds an extra axis. And instead of this just being a line, you live on the surface of a sphere.
Okay. So if a bit is 2 points on a line, a qubit is a 3D sphere where any of your quantum states are any point on the surface of that sphere?
That's right. And exactly.
Cool! That's amazing.
Okay, so qubits can give us way more possible computing power because they can ask many questions at the same time. Plus, when you're adding a computing unit, a qubit, you're getting way more bang for your buck than if you're adding another bit to a classical system. And that all sounds great. But those benefits are only true if you can ask your quantum system your questions in a way that makes sense, and then also read the answer that it's giving you in a way that means something to you.
If you measure it from the classical world, it doesn't give you the answer of what that any possibility is. It gives you that classical response back. So it gives you either 0 or 1.
Because you're asking it from a classical system?
Kind of, yeah. There is this sort of paradox in the sense you want this thing which is purely quantum mechanical, which can live in multiple states. But as soon as you interact with it from the classical world, which is where we're living and where we're going to construct all the problems we're asking, it interferes with that system and essentially imposes classicalness on it. So even the materials that you build the system out of, they effectively can measure the states of the quantum computer, and you don't know what question was asked. So that's what ends up making it like it randomly projects into one of those states. So that's a big source of error.
Well, it has to freeze at the moment it is in that time and give you where it is at that one moment. It's not going to give you all the possibilities that exist.
Sure, that's right.
Plus, there's this whole issue of noise. Because stuff on the quantum level is so freaking tiny, it can be disturbed by super tiny things, like the movement of molecules. And another way to put the movement of molecules is temperature.
The other aspect about quantum computing, unlike a phone that you carry around with you and it lives, you know, in warm and cold environments, quantum computer to keep those qubits pristine and keep them from getting perturbed by the environment, they have to be kept at extraordinarily cold temperatures.
Right, and I've seen the tank. It's like a big tank that, like,
That's
you need
right.
to keep at cryo temperatures, like as close to absolute zero as you can get.
Exactly right. And so those aren't things you can carry around with you. They're
yeah.
always going to be housed in some specialized facility.
So we've got the problem of the classical and quantum worlds interacting. We've got the noise issue. And then there's also the problem of scaling up.
We'll need them to get better in several dimensions. We'll need to have more qubits. We'll need to have better control over those qubits. And we'll need to be able to sustain those qubits from getting perturbed by the environment for long periods of time. And all of those are extremely challenging problems in manufacturing, in physics, in material science.
A hypothetical ideal quantum computer that we could reliably use to give us accurate answers to the questions that we ask it is sometimes called a universal quantum computer. But even if we can get there, what would this help us do? Like, what would this huge possible leap in computing actually mean for us?
I guess one of the best known things is the so-called Shor's factoring algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
And one aspect of modern cryptography involves factoring prime numbers, and I won't get into the details, but it's useful cryptographically because it's something you can represent with a short string,
mm-hmm.
and it's very hard to figure out how to break that apart, how to find out what the sort of secret key
right.
is.
Even
that
with
generated
a super
it.
Powerful
Even
classical
with a,
computer,
that's
it's
right.
really difficult for them to run through all of the possibilities, so it's hard to break into something if you use that algorithm to protect information.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, it's considered to be exponentially hard, so that means if I have 100 bits, then it's like 2 to the 100th power is the sort of the proportional amount of time naively required to figure that out.
Okay.
But if we had this hypothetical universal quantum computer, we just might be able to solve Shor's algorithm. Like, in a reasonable amount of time. Like, that would change computer security really drastically. But we've got a pretty long way to go before we can do something like that. Like, we're really not there yet.
We still need a few miracles before we're really in an age where quantum computing goes mainstream.
So even though we may not be at fully functioning quantum computing yet, the prototypes that are being built all over the world, including here at LLNL, are still very useful and necessary and can tell us a lot of important stuff.
I think in 10 years, we may see basic demonstrations of building blocks of this universal thing. But in this next 10 years, it's really going to be about how do we make the most use out of these systems. And then I think there will be huge impacts, again, on sort of basic science because we're able to build systems that normally we'd only get sort of given to us from nature. We can build them in a way so that it asks specific questions about basically how quantum mechanics works when you have lots of components.
Right, it's like, who knew building a quantum computer is going to tell you a lot about the quantum world?
Yeah.
That's like a very happy sort of almost byproduct of trying to build a quantum computer.
Absolutely. We also are in a position to help the field. I mean, that's also part of our role, is where we have this huge breadth of capabilities, you know, people in applied math, computer science, physics, biology, and we can all come together to look at different aspects of these problems. One on the side of trying to figure out, well, what is the useful thing you could do with this now? The other is, how can we solve these technical problems in terms of the materials, the control electronics, and all that kind of thing?
Exactly. Like, I think the interdisciplinary nature of the lab is really key to our experimentation in every field, including quantum computing.
That's right.
And where does quantum computing fit in with classical computing? While quantum computing may be able to do some things better than classical systems, we're still going to need classical computing. And a lot of it. Like, we're still going to need our upcoming exascale capabilities, aka the fastest and most powerful classical supercomputers in the world, in addition to quantum computing systems. And maybe we'll even need to use them together.
Our ability to continue to eat more out of our machines through architectural innovations, that'll last 5, 10, maybe 15 years. And that will give quantum computing more time to mature. At some point, as we're thinking about these very specialized computers, they won't look that different from a specialized computer made in a very different way, maybe from a different kind of physics. And so there might be a role then, in the same way we're using a host of specialized processors to do our computations, we could plug a quantum coprocessor into that mix to solve certain problems that quantum devices are very good at solving.
So you could see this sort of Lego house of a computer that has a classical computing component, a quantum component, and maybe a classical component that's been architected to do a very specific thing, maybe a conglomerate machine that would be really good at a lot of different things.
Exactly. There's this tremendous uncertainty about what computing will look like 10 or 15 or 20 years from now. And that can be scary, but it's also incredibly energizing and exciting. So we've been on this trajectory with Moore's Law for 50 years, and it's taken us to phenomenal places. And now as that reaches its end, we need fresh ideas, we need new ways of thinking about computing, we need new interdisciplinary collaborations. And those are things that labs are really good at, and so it's going to be a very exciting time.
Whew, okay. That was a lot, but hopefully it gave you guys some more insight into quantum computing and its place in our wider computing world. If you guys have questions about this or quantum mechanics or anything related, then leave them down for us in the comments below. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on all of our social media platforms to stay up to date with all of our videos, including ones like this that take you on a deep dive into super complex topics. And as always, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.